All right, here's the deal. The sermon, the teaching starts now, and I need your help with the introduction. And the introduction, if you don't walk away from anything else from today, I want you to walk away from this place with seven words. And the seven words very simply are these: the Lord has been good to us. And so in a couple of seconds, I'm going to start saying some things. I'm going to say something, and I'm going to point out at you. And your response is these seven words. You're going to get a chance to say it seven times. The Lord has been good to, not right in a row. I'll interrupt you sometimes. But just so just for practice, let's try it. Your point, when I point, your time is?
Lord has been good to us.
For giving us another day of life and breath. And a place to come in freedom and worship and honor his name. For from his hand we have received his abundant goodness and blessing. And he has blessed us and enabled us to bless others. For from his hand of protection we have gathered together for 19 years filled of Sundays. And not once has anybody ever suffered physical harm in this facility. From his hand of protection and his hand of provision, he has protected us thus far for 19 years from paralyzing division and from crippling scandal. For opening our eyes to see Jesus, for opening our hearts to respond to his message of repentance, for opening our hands to give with service and abundant generosity.
Lord, has been good to us.
For his abundant love and patience, for his abundant peace and his abundant grace.
Lord, has been good to us.
Let all of God's people say it one more time.
Lord, has been good to us.
And so in response, we sing a song that has been with the church for a long time. Congregations have sang this song, simply called Doxology. We sing it together. It goes like this. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Thank you. You may be seated today.
Almighty God, if we don't take anything else away from this place today, would you speak into my heart and into the hearts of everyone that's seated here today, and God, into the hearts of everyone who will listen to this over the internet. God, I pray that we would walk away, regardless of what we're walking through, with an understanding that you have been good to us in the past and that it is your desire to be good to us again. Father, as only your Spirit can do, would you drive that truth deep into our hearts and into our souls so that we can live life the way you want us to live life. You're God and you're good, and we will trust you. In the precious name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. I really do want you to walk away with that today, that the Lord has been good to us. As I thought about coming back, and I've missed being with you these last couple of weeks, and I just want to start by saying a word of thanks to our board of trustees. 3 weeks ago or 4 weeks ago, when I got the phone call from my dad, and then we talked to Autumn's mom, that a tornado, which we now know was an EF5 tornado, ripped through our hometown of Joplin, Missouri. I got word from my dad that their house had been destroyed, and from Autumn's mom that her house had been destroyed, thank you, and that they were fine. I called the board and just told them that it had happened, and without hesitation, they said, go as soon as you can, stay as long as you can, and they just were so gracious, and I just wanted to say thank you. I also want to say thank you to Pastor Patrick for the incredible job he did teaching while I was away, so let's tell him thank you. And, yeah, I'm very appreciative. Members of his life group did rat him out, though I had listened online, but members of his life group did rat him out, though, that he had struggled with one word, a combination of words which kind of came out wrong or incorrectly, and so they ratted him out, but he'd already confessed a little bit about that. So I'm just so thankful for him and for the rest of the staff that stepped up and allowed me to be gone, and I don't know what to tell you this morning other than my time away has changed me. It's going to be up to you over the course of time to see whether or not you see that. But I am a different person than I was when I walked off this stage 3 weeks ago. I saw some horrific things. Things that I prayed to my Almighty God that I never see again. And I saw some beautiful things. Beautiful things that I hope that I get to see every single day for the rest of my life. And people have been asking me over the course of time. By the way, I also want to say thank you to all of you who sent emails and texts and called Autumn and called the church office to check on us. My mom and dad and Autumn's mom wanted to send their thanks to you to say thank you for all of the prayers. And so we truly appreciate that. I've told people a long time or while I was away that Joplin is my hometown, but this is my home. And so to hear from you through the time I was down there just moved me in incredible ways. And so thank you for that. But people would keep asking, how are you? How you doing? How you doing? And I struggled to find a phrase for that. How do I describe how I'm doing? I can't quite put words on it. And so I've been wrestling with that. And I even came back this week, and I had two pastors here in the Miamisburg area simply have conversations with me. They knew where I'd been, and they simply asked, well, started with how you doing, and then they asked this question in different ways, but this was the question they were asking. So how do you deal with a God who does that to a city because the city is so evil? Really? And I wrestle with that, and I wrestle with those kind of things. And so people ask me, how are you doing? How are you doing? And I just want to tell you, I've come up with a phrase that best describes how I'm doing. And the phrase very simply would be this: stirred but not shaken. I'm stirred but not shaken. I stand in front of you today. For the last 3 years, we've been going through this ancient text, this beautiful ancient text, and I've said to you, the story of this ancient text very simply is this: there is a God, he is good, and he can be trusted. And I stand in front of you today having experienced what Autumn and I and our girls have experienced over the last year. A year ago this month, Autumn was back in Missouri moving her dad from his home to the place where he'll spend the rest of his life, the Missouri Veterans Home, because of his deteriorating health. Later on, towards the end of last year, we heard about my mom's deteriorating health, and we got word that Autumn's mom had stage 4 ovarian cancer. And then 3 weeks ago, we get word that both of our parents' homes had been destroyed and wiped out. And there are lots of things and lots of questions, but I stand in front of you to tell you very much, I am not shaken. There is a God. He is good, and he can be trusted, even when we do not understand, even when we can't figure it out. That conviction and that belief has not been changed inside of me. But I also stand in front of you today understanding that God is stirring some things up inside of my soul. God is stirring some things up that I have let die. God is stirring some things up that I can no longer put on hold. God is stirring up a sense of urgency and a sense of direction and a sense of, one pastor I've talked to talks about it as unction inside of me. And so I want to start with you today, and I don't know how long this teaching series is going to last, with a teaching series I'm simply calling Stirred. There are some things inside of us that I think need to be stirred up. And so I want to help you figure out what those things are. But in order for us to get at this today, this first thing that needs to stir us up, I need to ask you to journey back with me to 1973. To 1973, when this was the song that was number 3 on the Billboard Top 100, and this was the song that was number 1 on the easy listening charts. Enjoy as you listen to this song back in 1973. Sing along if you must. Everybody.
Sing a song. Sing out loud. Sing out strong. Sing of good things, not bad.
That's all you get. And some of, yeah, I heard the, oh, some of you grew up in like the 1970s. Oh, this is my favorite song ever. Please, please play more. And some of you are like, I did not grow up in the 70s.
The Lord has been good to me. Right? I did not have to listen to that music. It was a beautiful thing. You've burned my ears. This song, by the way, the Carpenters made it famous. It was a cover tune for them. It was a cover tune for Barbara Streisand, and it was a cover tune for Sammy Davis Jr. You remember where it originated? Yeah, I heard Sesame Street. This was a Muppet song. This was a Muppet song, and these people made it famous. And this was a song I had to sing in grade school. And I couldn't sing then, and I can't sing now. And as I was traveling around Joplin, going to different places, I went by my elementary school to see the damage that had been done to that. And all these memories start rushing back. And this is one of the memories. I remembered Miss Cotton Gin. She taught music on a cart. And she wheeled it into our cart, and she had the record player, and she put the record player on it, and she turned it on. And we had to sing this song. And it caused great pain. It always made me laugh. What made me laugh back then still makes me laugh today. It's a song about singing a song, for goodness sake. Who writes a song about singing a song? And not only do you write a song about it, but then you sing a song about singing a song. What's that about? Tucked into your Bible right there in the very middle of it is a book we call the Psalms. It's a book of songs. There's 150 of them, to be exact. And Psalm 96 is a song about singing a song. I want to invite you to take your Bibles out and find Psalm 96. You might find it in your Bible, the Psalms. If you're following along with one of those red Bibles there, the page numbers presented there for you. This is a song about singing a song. And as I read this song about singing a song, I think it's a song. I could tell those of you that immediately heard that music, you had an emotional connection with that song. It immediately took you someplace. And this song would have had music, and this song about singing a song would have taken people someplace. And it would have begun to put inside of them these feelings of, oh, I remember when. And it began to stir up inside of them certain things. By the way, if you don't have a Bible of your very own, would you stop by the connection desk on your way out? I would love to give you a copy of God's Word that you can take home to be your very own, no charge. Please stop by and pick one of those up. But Psalm 96 is a song about singing a song, and it starts this way. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name, proclaim his salvation day after day, declare his glory among all the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the people. Sing a song about singing a song. And I wonder, why in the world is that there? I want to answer that question, why, but I want to ask the question, how? It says, sing to the Lord. First of all, it says a new song. I'll talk to you about the new song at the very end of today's teaching. But three times right off the bat, it says, sing a song, sing a song, sing a song. What I want you to notice, if you would please, is to whom this song is supposed to be directed. The song is to be directed to the Lord. If you're following along in your Bible, you'll notice that the Lord is in all caps, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. It's the way English translators have chosen consistently to communicate this most holy and most reverent name of God. It's the name we would say Yahweh from the Hebrew. It's four letters, the Yod, Hey, Va, Hey. And it's this, we've talked about before, that it's the very breath of God that Yahweh. When you breathe in and you breathe out, you're uttering the very name of God. It's this precious and holy name that they don't want to even write. And so our English translators communicate it by capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. Well, what does this name mean? Well, to help you understand what this name means, why don't you watch this with me? Maybe you'll remember this scene from The Prince of Egypt.
Here I am. Take the sandals from your feet. For the place on which you stand is holy ground. Who are you? I am that I am.
And so we see a name or we see a word in the scriptures, and we always want to ask ourselves, where did this occur for the first time? Where do we begin to encounter this? And you take the name Lord, Yod Heh Vav Heh, all the way back to Genesis chapter 3, when God's people had been in slavery, and God heard their cry and he saw their misery and he was concerned, and he was going to send them a rescuer and a redeemer named Moses, but he was out in the desert taking care of sheep, and God had to get his attention, and God got his attention through a burning bush. And Moses' first question when he saw the bush on fire was very simply, who are you? By the way, I'm working on another teaching series, and hopefully something else that most of the time when things like tornadoes or fires or that kind of stuff happens, what's our first question? Our first question is why? It's not the right first question. The right first question is who? Who are you, Moses says. That's another teaching for another time. And God reveals himself by this name, I am. I am who I am. Some translations say, I am the one who is. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, as you begin to work your way through this, the first thing God actually says, he uses an interesting way to describe himself. He doesn't use a noun. He doesn't use an adjective. He uses a future-oriented verb phrase. And it's very telling. This future-oriented verb phrase in Hebrew is Ayah Asher Ayah. It's for the Ayah, is from where we get Yahweh. Ayah Asher Ayah. And literally it would mean am that am. Some of you would learn it, will be that will be. There's this interesting understanding among the Jewish rabbis about how this phrase should be translated. They say this phrase should be translated this way. Because God uses this future-oriented verb phrase, they say it should be translated this way. I will be known by what I do. I will be known by what I do. Hey, Moses, you want to know who I am? Tell your people to hold on to their seats. Because I'm going to be the one who will be known by what I do. And so in this new song that we're supposed to sing to the Lord, this song that begins to stir inside of me, this first thing that's stirring inside of me is that when we sing to the Lord, he's the one who will be known by what he does. Look with me, if you would, again at the first three stanzas of Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. It's a reference to creation. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation. Day after day, and to Moses and to those people there, it meant we were in slavery and we cried out and God saw our misery and he heard our cry and he sent us a rescuer and a redeemer. And he led us from the land of slavery to the land of freedom. And he fed us every day and he protected us and he cared for us. He was the one who did everything we needed him to do. He brought us salvation. Proclaim his salvation day after day after day. He's the God who's known by what he did. He saved them, he rescued them, he redeemed them. And for those of us who are followers of Christ now, our message is he's still the God of salvation. He's the God who saw our misery and heard our cry and was concerned. And he sent Jesus Christ to planet Earth, fully God, fully human, to rescue us and redeem us and save us. Sing to the Lord a new song. Let it stir inside of your heart that he's the God who should be known by what he does. Verse 3, stanza 3, declare to the Lord, declare his glory among all the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the people. Tell what he did. Tell what he did. There are some of you here struggling with your faith and struggling. How do I share my faith? What do I do? I don't know what to say. I might not have all the answers. And what needs to stir inside of your heart is very simple. I need to tell them what God did for me. And there are some of you in the room today that desperately need God to act on your behalf. And you don't know if he will. You don't know if you can trust him. I simply want to tell you he's God, he's good, and you can trust him. Cry out and watch him act. He's the God who is known by what he does. Why would I want to do that? Why would I want to sing a new song? That just sounds ludicrous, right? To sing a new song. Stanza 4 says it this way, for great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. All I've got for you on that is he's worth it. He's worth it. You sing this song to him simply because he's worth it. No other reason. And in a few minutes when I'm done teaching, we're going to give you a time for an extended period of praise and worship where you can just sing to him because he's worth it. He's worth it. Then he does this interesting thing. The songwriter does this interesting thing. It says he's to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols. But Yahweh, the one who is known by what he does, look what he did. He made the heavens. All the other gods are idols, but the God who's known by what he does, he created the heavens. Now, what you need to understand at this time in the ancient world, there's some serious God competition going on. If you want to know about the God competition that's going on in the ancient world, all you need to do is go to Google and Google ancient gods of Egypt. And I promise you, you can spend as much time there as you want to spend. And you're going to find out that the gods of Upper Egypt are different from the gods of Lower Egypt. That the gods of Egypt, man, they have all kinds of gods for everything. They have the god of the flowers. They had the god of the sun. They have the god of the moon. They have the god of the stars. They have the god of the river. They have the god of the rainbow. They have the god of the crops. They have the god of the grass. They have god of the dirt. They have a god for everything, a god or a goddess for everything. There's some serious god competition to go on. And when you have all of these gods, you have to know, which god do I need to make happy? I want my crops to go, so I want to make sure I pray to the right god. It doesn't change much in Greek and Roman culture, does it? They have a god for everything. You're taking passage on the sea. You want safe passage. You pray to Poseidon. You don't pray to Zeus, you pray to Poseidon. And so there's this sense, there's some serious God competition going on. One of my favorite pictures that describes this serious God competition is this piece of artwork
And there are three gods represented in this piece of artwork. You'll notice, first of all, the goddess who is arched over. You see her arched over there, her feet right here, and then it just follows around. This is the goddess Nut. She always appears naked, and she always appears covered in stars because she is the goddess of the sky. Represented under Nut, every time that her picture appears, is her husband. He is Geb, and you'll see his body's painted as well. He's the god of the earth. And you see to your right, the guy over there yelling touchdown, doing touchdown, right? That is Nut's father, the god Shu. And you'll see he always has something in his hands. And what he has in his hands is a blanket or something that you'll notice. His job, he's the god who kept the sky from crashing into the earth. And so in this ancient world, there's some serious god competition going on. And God says, what I want to stir inside of your heart is you don't need to look any further than the God of creation. Yahweh is his name. He is the one who is known by what he does. And what he did was he created everything. You want to know who's in charge? You want to know who's to rule? You want to know who's to reign? It's him. Don't look any place else. And this new song that we sing, it should stir inside of our heart that we don't need to look any place further than creation to find the God that we want to love and the God that we want to worship. Then it says simply in verse 6, splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary. In the ancient world, if you wanted to get close to the god, you would go to their temple, you'd go to their sanctuary. And the further you went into the temple, the more pictures of the god or the goddess you would see. The closer you got to the center of the sanctuary, the more brilliant the hieroglyphs, or the more brilliant the gold would become, and the more brilliant the statues. And in the very center where the god was supposed to be, it was represented by the most beautiful picture or painting or statue that you could imagine. 1,000 years before Jesus, this guy named Solomon builds a temple in Jerusalem, the place where God's name will rest, the place where God will dwell. And if you go into his temple, you're going to find out that there are no pictures, there are no images, there's nothing like that, but it's strength and honor that go before him. It's strength and honor and glory that are in his sanctuary. In fact, if you get to the holiest place in the temple of God, there are no pictures, there are no carvings, there are no statues. What you find is the Ark of the Covenant. Ark means box, and covenant means binding agreement. What you find there in the holiest of holy places is the box of binding agreement. And inside this box of binding agreement are two tablets of stone where God wrote on them the Ten Commandments. You remember? He gave them to Moses. Some of the ones you might remember: no other gods besides me. Make for yourselves no graven images. Don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Which, just let me say, we've talked about what that means many times. When I did a sermon on the Ten Commandments, we talked about what that means to not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. But just for today, let me simply say, I think one of the things it probably means for us today in the 21st century is when you're texting, don't use OMG. It's taking the name of your Lord your God in vain. And it ought to stir inside of your heart that he is worthy, and strength and glory and majesty are his, and he's not to be taken for granted. And then he does this interesting thing. I sing to the Lord a new song. I sing a song about singing a song because he's worth it, because he's the God when nothing else is. Look what he says. He says, for all the gods of the nations are idols. All the gods of the nations are idols. The Hebrew word there is Elil. It's E-L-I-L. And it literally means nothing. Some of your translations say all of the gods are worthless idols. Worthless is more accurate. It's not idols. It's what he's saying is all the gods, all the other gods are nothings. They're nothings. You have a statue of Nut, and she's wooden, and you burn her, and she comes to ashes, and she's not a goddess. You have a statue of Geb, and it gets burned, or it gets broken. It's marble, and it gets broken, and he's nothing. They're idols, they're nothing. Every other god. And so what he wants to stir inside of you is wherever else you're turning, other than the God of the universe, other than the creator God, you're looking to the wrong place. And it ought to stir inside of you that you have this sense, I just need to turn to the God who's known by what he does. And there's some of you in the room today that are looking for God to do something on your behalf, and you're not sure he'll do it. And he hasn't done it as fast as you've wanted him to do it, and you're starting to look to someplace else. I just want to tell you, you're looking at the wrong place. Look to the God of the universe. Then he says in stanza 7, ascribe to the Lord all you families of nations. Let me stop there. Some of you, when we talk about this, you talk about, we talk about a God who's God and all the other gods aren't gods. Tim, I don't like that. That makes me kind of uncomfortable. You're saying that there's one God, and that sounds kind of exclusive to me. We live in a world that doesn't like to exclude anybody from anything. But what I want to tell you is this is not an exclusive song. This is an inclusive song. Ascribe to the Lord all you families of the nations. Everyone's invited.
No one's excluded. Everyone's invited. Everyone's invited, but there has to come a point in time when you surrender to him as the God of the creator of the universe, when you surrender to his son, Jesus. But everyone's invited. No one's excluded. Then it simply says, ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. To ascribe simply means to give. Maybe I could say, ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Has this ever happened to you? Maybe it happened in school when you were working with a group on a group project. Maybe it's happened at your workplace when you were working with a team. And your assignment or your task was to come together with a unified presentation. And the reality of it is you did 98, 99, 97% of the work. And the presentation is made and your boss or your teacher really liked it. And when they asked how did the group function together, somebody else took credit for it. Have you ever had somebody else take credit for your work? Did it just tick you off or what? I would think it would. And what God's saying is, I'm tired of other people getting credit for my work. I'm so tired of somebody else getting credit for my work. Give me the credit that I'm due. You think there are all these other gods out there? They didn't do any of the work. Give me the credit that I'm due. And that's what this new song says. We sing this song and you give to God the credit that he is due. And then I love what it says. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him all the earth. Then verse 10, stanza 10 says this. Say among the nations, the God who's known by what he does, he reigns. He's in charge. He's on the throne. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. My friends, I stand in front of you today, stirred but not shaken. No tornado, no fire that's blazing across America, no tsunami, no anything else can move me from the fact that God is on the throne and he reigns and he rules and he is king and I am not. Some claim, we said this when I was doing this series on the Ten Commandments a long time ago, and we started talking about the name of God and we said his name is I Am. Remember what I told you? That very simply means you are not. If he is, you are not. He's in charge. He's the one that's on the throne. He's the one to whom we surrender. And I love this. It says, say among the nations, the one who's known for what he does reigns. My friend, can you surrender to the fact this day, whatever it is you're walking through, whatever it is you face, that God is on the throne. He has your plan and he has your life in control. Then he invites us into this beautiful thing, verse 11, 12, and 13. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea resound and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Let all the trees of the forest sing for joy. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord. This song about singing a song that should stir something inside of you should say, just look around you. Look around at the God who's known for what he does and just look at his creation. It was World Ocean Day this last week. Did you know? Did you celebrate World Ocean Day? Most of the time, World Ocean Day is presented to us in terms of we need to be careful because of all the animals that are going extinct, and it's made about the animals. I would say as stewards of God's world, we need to be careful about the animals that are going extinct, but it's not about the animals. It's about the creator who created them. And every animal that you look at that lives inside the ocean, this passage of scripture says, if you don't sing this new song, they're going to sing. And everything that is in the ocean, and you're standing by the ocean, and the waves just beat up and back against the shore, and you're like, there's something bigger, there's someone bigger than I am. Let all the flowers of the field, let all of the crops bow down and worship. It's the picture of this new song when it finally surrenders to the creator of the universe. And there's something stirring inside of my soul that says, we as a community of faith, me as an individual, we need to be back about the fact that he is the creator of the universe. And that's all we need to tell anybody else. You're not sure what to say about God? Proclaim his deeds, his creation, his salvation, his redemption. It's this beautiful, beautiful thing. When we were in Missouri, or when I was in Missouri, in my parents' house, they lived in a plat, they lived in a development that was built kind of on some old forest land, and they're kind of all beautiful trees that were hundreds and hundreds of years old. And one of my first glimpses of my parents' house was coming in from the back, and I don't know, they probably had 20 trees in their backyard, and these trees that had stood tall and proud for hundreds of years, and all of them had been blown from the south to the north, and they're laying all facing the north at that point. And I just simply remember this passage of scripture, and something started to stir inside my soul. Those trees know what it means to bow down to the creator of the universe, who is in charge. They can't stand in spite of him, and you and I can't stand in spite of him either. There comes a point in time when you have to sing this new song. My friend, would you let it stir inside of your soul who God is and that he's the God who's known by what he does? Fast forward with me, if you would please, to Jesus' ministry. The God who's known by what he does. John chapter 8, Jesus is among a crowd that catches a woman who's caught in adultery, and the people want to stone her.
And Jesus says, no, you without sin, cast the first stone, and this woman who's caught in adultery is let go. And Jesus and the religious elite begin to get in this conversation. They begin to get in this debate about who Jesus is and who they are. And they're like, you don't even know who your dad is. We're children of Abraham. And then Jesus, John chapter 8, verse 58 is where it's recorded. Jesus says this amazing thing. Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am. And everybody that was religious there at that moment became a rock collector because they wanted to stone him. Because in their opinion, he had just committed blasphemy. Because you know what he's saying? I'm the God who will be known by what I do. He was comparing himself to the creator of the universe, not just comparing himself, but equating himself. I am God. And they couldn't believe it. And I would simply ask you today, if you want to know who God is, look at Jesus. He's the God who's known by what he did. And he sent Jesus, his only son, to planet Earth to live a life of perfection and die a death on a cross so that you could live. He's the God who rescued the children of Israel. He's the God who sees your misery, hears your cry, and wants to rescue and save you. Proclaim his salvation. You don't know what else to tell anybody about who God is? Tell them how he changed your life. Proclaim that day after day and see what a difference that makes in the world. But then Jesus does this amazing thing. He lives a life. He challenges people to follow him. He dies a death on a cross. He's put in a tomb. He rises from the dead. He appears over the earth for the course of 40 days. And then he ascends into heaven. Before he ascends into heaven, he grabs his followers and he has them meet him on a hillside. And he says these amazing words to them. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go into all the world and make disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey all that I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always. Again, he compares himself to God. You see, the plan, very simply, is this. For Moses and those who sing the new song, he's the God of the universe. He's the creator. He's the God of salvation, the rescuer, and the redeemer. For those of us that live now, he's the God who's the creator. He's the rescuer and the redeemer. And his plan for his name to get out there and for his name to be known now is you and me. And I don't know about you, but I want to spend the rest of my life being the kind of person who's known for what I do. And I want our community of faith to be the kind of community of faith that's known for what we do. My friends, if you don't think it's possible for a small group, a small community of faith to be known by what they do across the world, you haven't been paying attention. I told you I saw some horrific things. Some things I'm not ready to talk about. Some things I don't know that I'll ever be ready to talk about. But one of the horrific things I saw while I was in Joplin was a community of faith that showed up from Kansas with signs at the outskirts of every corner of town that said, this is God's judgment. This was an evil town. You know the name of the church, Westboro Baptist Church. They show up at military funerals proclaiming God's judgment on soldiers and families. They are known by what they do. They are known by what they do all across the world. And we can be known by what we do. Hopefully not those kind of things. We can be known as the kind of people. What did Jesus spend his life doing? Two things. The scriptures say he spent his life, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. And the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. I don't know about you, but I want to spend the rest of my life helping people who don't know God find their way back to God. That's what it means to seek the lost. Helping people who are far away from God understand that a bridge has been built and his name is Jesus. Look at what he did. I want to spend the rest of my life serving those kind of people who deserve to be served. And who did Jesus serve? Jesus served the kind of people who couldn't help his mission and his ministry out one iota. They couldn't pay money. They didn't have prestige. They didn't have popularity. They were lepers and prostitutes and tax collectors and the people nobody else in the rest of society wanted anything to do with. And Jesus said, I'll touch the leper, I'll heal the blind. And he went around preaching a simple 17-word sermon. The time has come. The kingdom of God has drawn near. Repent and believe the good news. That's how I want to spend the rest of my life. I want us as a community of faith to be known for what we do. There are lots of things that churches can be known for. Our doctrine. I don't think that's what God wants us to know. Don't get me wrong, doctrine's important. But the doctrine that matters is that there's a God, he's good and you can trust him. He's the creator of the universe and he wants such a relationship with you through salvation that he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for you, to rise from the dead so that you could have everlasting life. And that he spent his life going around seeking the lost and serving the least. And I've let that die inside of me. And one of the things that's beginning to stir inside of me that I can't fathom from here on out, yeah, that's still emotion, that's still all that, just, you know, all that you're still struggling with. I don't think that's the case. I've been there before. He's the God who's known by what he did. Jesus was the God who's known by what he did. And Jesus sent his followers into the whole world to be known by what they do, to seek the lost and serve the least. It's stirring inside of my soul. I don't know what all of that means. We're going to develop it together over the course of these next few weeks and months. But as I pray, as the praise team gets ready to come on up, guys, if you want to, here's what I want to ask you. Are you here today and you need God to act on your behalf and you don't think he will? It starts with crying out. And every time God's people cry out, we talk about it this way, it's the cry that inaugurates human history. Every time you cry out, God acts. He sees your misery, he hears your concern, and he sees your misery, he hears your cry, and he is concerned. And there are some of you, truth be told, you're not shaken either. You believe he's God, you believe he's good. But the fact that he's the God who's worthy to be praised is not stirring inside of your soul. What we want to do for the next few minutes is give you an opportunity to let that begin to stir inside of you one more time. To sing, to praise, just because he's worth it. Almighty God, I come in front of you right now. And I ask you that you would continue to speak into our hearts. You are God and you are good and you are worthy of our praise. And Father, just for the next few minutes, simply because you're worth it. We want to take everything else that's on our minds, everything else that we think we need to go do today and get done today, God, we just put that aside. And for the next few minutes, God, we focus on you, the creator of the universe. And we will sing to you a new song. Father, I ask that your spirit would speak into those hearts this morning that just aren't stirred. God, stir inside of them. That they will be people known by what they do. May we be a group of people known for helping people find the way back to God, for serving the least. Elizabeth's going to sing in just a minute. I told you I'd talk to you about the new song. You know the words to the old song. The old song is, this life is about me and mine. And the new song is, I will live my life for God, for he is worthy of praise. Almighty God, as we come in front of you, you are indeed worthy to be praised. And we want to live our lives to glorify your name. Father, we join with all of creation, the oceans and the trees and the fields and the forests. And we proclaim you are the God who is known by what you do. You have created us. You have sustained us. You have made a plan to redeem us and to save us. So God, I pray for my brothers and sisters that they would hold on to who you are. That the why question would start to disappear and that the who question would become very abundantly clear. You are God. You are good. And we trust you. And now, my brothers and sisters, as you leave this place, may you go in the love of the Father, in the peace of his Son, and the power of his Spirit. And may you be known this week as a child of God, known for what you do, loving the least and the lost. God be with you. Till Lord willing, we're back in this place again next week. Peace be with you.